One of the most important new developments for Mango was also keying and of course rotoscoping. So in the following video I want to demonstrate some of the workflows that we used. So first I'm going to go to the motion tracking interface to open up a shot. And to demonstrate that I'm going to use the shot 5-4N, which is one of the tech headshots. And since I'm already at home, I don't have the 4K footage with me, so I just use the Linear HD, which is a bit low res, but still good enough. So this is the shot, and first I'm going to cache that into the RAM, because we will have to do some tracking. So F to go to the full frame, so that I can see everything. So it's quite an even green screen, so it's quite good at first glance. But if you go to display and then only enable the green channel, then you can see that it's in fact not as even as it could be. Still, it's quite good. So the thing that we have to mask is of course this stuff, because you can see here some green and, well, he is moving his arm gun. So that is something for rotoscoping. Maybe I can limit the shot to 150 frames, just to make it easier. Okay, so first of all, if you're going to key something, you of course go to the node editor. So I go here to the node editor, and since I don't need the dope sheet, I expand that so that I have down here my movie clip editor and up here the node editor. Use nodes, use backdrop, we don't need the render layer, and then go full screen and then shift A, input movie clip. I'm going to use 5-4N of course, control shift left click to see that. So this is our shot. Okay, so before in previous Blender versions we had already some good keying tools, for example the channel key, that was quite good. So if you drag that in here, then you can have a look at the mat, and you can see this has to be tweaked a bit, because this is almost white. So if I would clip the lows to something like this, then this starts to be a decent key. Now the good thing here is of course that we have great footage, so instead of having this pixelated crap that you would have if you're shooting with a cheap camera or a DSLR, this is now nice and keyable. When using the channel key, I would go from the maximum algorithm to single and then key against the red channel, which gives much better results. So something about here, you can see we still have some of the hairs left, but then to get rid of everything else I would have to clip even more. So in that case that works great, but this is also because, well, it's quite a good green. So if this would be a different color or something, then the channel key might be not as good anymore, because it only keys against one channel. Maybe I can demonstrate that by going to the converter and then separate RGBA. So here this is the red channel and this is the green channel, and basically the channel key makes use of these two channels by using some math internally. So if I subtract the red channel from the green channel with a simple math node, then I get already a decent result, and then can go to converter color ramp, invert that, and then this is very similar to what we had before. So now I can also clip the blacks and get also a nice result. Okay, but well, there are a few things missing yet, and that is, for example, the despill, and then we don't have any feathering or soft edges control, and for that we can use the new keying node. So instead of the channel key, maybe we can just keep that up here, we can also use the new keying node. So mat and then keying, and this has a lot more controls than the channel key. So I can now drag the image here and then control shift click on the image and then grab one of the colors here. So the key color could be this green. And then if you look at the mat to better see what your key actually is, this is without any tweaks already quite good. And now you can also clip the blacks. So if you do that, it will take away much more of this dark color. And I mean, you can clip very far. And the difference to the channel key is that you keep some of the hair detail. I mean, it's it does look a bit crappy, but if you look at this, there is more of the detail left. Control H to only show the matte channel to be able to easier switch. So there's a lot more detail left, but you can see that there's this weird fringing around the hairs, and that is because of this edge tolerance setting. And this is one of the great things about this new keying node, that you have actual edge control. So by increasing the radius, you will increase the radius that this clipping will not go into. So when you clip the blacks, or when you don't use the clipping, this edge kernel control will have no influence. But clipping the blacks will now only use the stuff that is controlled by the edge kernel. So you have to find a setting that fits well and that looks okay. Also, in this case, going so far with the blacks is really not a good idea. So instead, what I did for most of these shots, I was using different masks. So it had one mask for the hair, and then some stuff for the background, and then eventually a third or even a fourth mask for some other areas. Okay, but that's how you clip the blacks. You can also clip the whites. So for example, you could try to get rid of this stuff. So this is also in the original shot. It's a bit greenish, so the green channel would pick this up, but you can try to limit that by clipping the whites. The problem is that now, still, this is not correct, and now you really get harsh edges here in some cases. So in that case, what you can do is to create a core mask. But I will come to that later. Before, I want to show you another thing, how you can key certain areas of your footage. So Control H to show all the stuff again. So I want to show you the keying screen, but before that I want to show you something about the keying color. So that is something that Campbell implemented a while ago for every of these color picking fields. So what you can do is to click here, and then if you use the color picker, you can click, and if you keep the left mouse button clicked, then you will average the color that is under the this color picker. So if I now go with my mouse into the face of him, then it will slowly start to get more orange, purple. I mean, these colors will be mixed into the green. So as long as you are holding your left mouse button, you will average the colors. And that is of course very nice if you want to grab a bigger area of this green. So if you just click once, you get this brighter green, but not these darker tones. So if I now go back to my background area or to my matte channel, then now you can see, even though the clipping is a bit less, now it's picking up more of these colors here. In fact, it's going a lot further. Now the thing is, you can do that by just doing this and using these controls. And then in some cases that also really helps, but doing that will not give you the control over the edges. So it's always something that you would have to try what gives the best results. But the other thing that I wanted to show you is to use the keying screen. So instead of using just a single color, you can also go ahead and go to matte and then keying screen, which is first a very weird node. But what you can do here is if you go into your movie clip and then add some tracking markers. And maybe don't do that if you're doing camera tracking in the camera object, but you can create a second object, call that for example mask, and now if I add a marker here, then these markers will be used to pick the color. And especially if you're using quite static camera images like this one, then that's really a nice thing to do. Because now Blender will average the green between all these colors and use that as an input. So to show you, I go here and select the movie clip, then the mask object. And now we have here this averaged colors. Now the problem with that is, and that is why I didn't really use it that much, is that it also produces some weird edges. So if I now click on the mat, it's all fine, but it's also clipping a lot. So if I go back, okay, now here you can see that between these averaged areas, there are some still some edges and some strange results. So for these, I would still have to clip the blacks, and eventually would have to separate the hairs nonetheless. So I didn't really end up using the keying screen that much, but it's still very nice to do. Now, the other problem with the keying screen is that if you have a moving camera or moving objects, then here, for example, here it looks totally fine, but then here you can see that now this color is within my keying screen. So if I click on that, now this is averaged between these colors as well. And that's, of course, a big problem. So in that case, what you can do is to track that, but then you would have to offset the anchor point. So what you do is you bring the marker here and then press double G so that you can drag these areas, but the color will be picked from outside there. So if I track that, you can see how this moves, and the colors that are being picked are only here inside of the hair, but in the rest of the time it will be not within the head or the hair. So that way you can give an offset to these keying screen markers. Also, you can of course do that here. So if you add the marker here to pick the color from this green, you can press double G, offset it, track this point, and now you won't run the risk of having a marker that is going inside of this background area. But of course, if the person here is walking in front of that, it will still be problematic. So anyway, that's why I didn't really end up using it, but still it's a nice feature too if you want to use it. So instead, what I've been doing is to separate multiple keying notes with masks. And that brings me to my next topic, maybe to first try to conclude this. If I want to use that now, I can test it by going to color and then alpha over, bring this in the second input so that this image is now alpha overed over this one. And this is just a white color now, so maybe make it something dark reddish tone or something. And if I look at that, it looks like this. The one thing that we still have to do is to enable convert pre-multiply, because here the colors are not pre-multiplied by the alpha channel. And that's why we have all these nice hair details, but also we have this blue background. So by pre-multiplying that, it gives me a cleaner background, but it also takes away some of the hairs. And to take care of the hairs, we will just create a better keying note. So with this one, we take away most of the stuff in the background. Maybe we can go even stronger with the clipping. So that still gives nice results in these areas. Could be maybe feathered a bit to make it a bit smoother. Maybe make it with spherical feathering so that has a different fall off to the feather something. Okay, so that is this. And now I want to have a better key for the hairs. And to do that, I create a mask. And for masking, first what I want to do is to track the head of this person, because he's moving his head a lot. So what I do is to maybe try to use the perspective, the planar tracking. Set it to previous keyframe, because this is, well, it's not really a plane. Perspective tracking, a plane would be the best, but I think this would still work reasonably fast. So that looks okay. Okay, so that is this, and now we have tracked his head and we can attach a mask to that. Now for masking, you would have to go to the masking interface by going from tracking to mask mode, or by pressing tab and then 4. And that brings you to the masking interface, and now I can create a new mask and then control left click around his head, just a few points like so. Then you can right click select them, and with G you grab and move, just the normal Blender commands to move stuff. And to close it, I can either use the button in the tool shelf or the hotkey Alt C for close the mask. Now we have this mask here, and we can use that already by going to the compositor and then Shift A, input, mask, then pick the mask. And now you will see one problem, and that is the mask is weirdly small. And the reason for that is that the mask by default is using the scene settings, and the scene settings, the scene properties, are using a certain resolution and percentage. Now, the footage is 1920 by 1012 instead of 1080. So this is also the resolution that we have to use for our shot, or that we ideally that we should use. And the most important thing here is to adjust the resolution percentage as well. So set this to 100%. Now if I refresh by control clicking here, this is now fitting nicely to the rest. So this is now the result of the mask, and we can use that to separate a second keying node. So I can maybe just duplicate that one. And I want to keep the connection, so I control shift D duplicate it. So that will keep the connection to that input here. And let's say this should be the mask for the hair area. Or actually, no, this should be the overall mask, and this will be the mask for just the hair. So in this mask, I make sure that everything is black. And I think that we could even use a third mask just to fix this area. But for now, I want to use this one, maybe make the green a bit darker. Okay, so that's a nice background. Maybe some white clipping for some of these problems. And then this stuff we have to take care of separately. Okay, so this is the overall mask. And now to get some better hair detail, I take this keying node and adjust it so that it fits to the hair. So first, select the right green, then go to the mat and maybe set back the feathering, also get rid of some of the clipping, maybe adjust the kernel radius. And another thing that always helps if you have hair details that you want to take care of is to play around with these edge tolerance settings and also the screen balance. So I cannot really explain what exactly is going on behind the scenes, but it's always helpful to play around with these settings just to see where and how you can get a better key. Pre-blurring, well, the name says it all, it will pre-blur. So before it starts keying, it will blur everything. That is a way to get rid of some of the speckle that you have sometimes here. So this, for example, you can get rid of by blurring 2 pixels. But of course, it will also make the mask a bit blurry. So you always have to see if it really helps or not. Okay, it's not perfect, but for now it's good enough. So there are a little bit more hair details left. Yeah, maybe, I mean, this is not great, but maybe this is okay. All right, now add a mix node. And by the way, we should also use hide preview and highlight, and maybe smaller chunk size. Okay, so this is the overall mask, and I put this into the first input. Then we've got the second mask, and this will now, the hair mask will now replace everything else. So at this point, our mix result will be this. Like so. But now we want to limit that to just the hair area, and we can do that by using the mask as a factor input. And now we've got that. It looks a bit weird in this area, and that is because here it gets clamped, or it gets cut off by the mask. And then we have this very sharp mask. So one thing that I want to do is to add some feathering to the mask. So if you want to feather something, then in the mask settings, or in the mask itself, you shift click on one of these points, on one of these control points, you shift left click, and if you hold down the shift key, you can drag out this feather control area, and that will now, well, it will grow the mask a bit by the amount of feathering. And now we've got all these hair details. Now we can see there are some problems, so for that, I will just make this a bit smaller. Like so. And this is not a great key, but it's good enough. So now, of course, if I look at my alpha over, still it didn't change a lot. And of course it didn't, because now we have this alpha channel, but the alpha channel is still not used by the image. So what I want to do is to grab the input or the output of this keying node and put it into a set alpha node, so that this despilled image will be the image that is used. And then the alpha channel that will be set here, we replace that with our alpha channel that we just created here. So that is this. And this still doesn't look very different. And that is because this image isn't pre-multiplied yet. Now we can, of course, just pipe it into this alpha over node and use the convert pre-multiply. But what we did was to use the converter alpha convert node to manually pre-multiply that, because now we can output this mask just like that and use it maybe as PNG sequence or EXR sequence with alpha channel in some of the viewports. Okay, now I just duplicate that and put it in here. Make sure that you don't double pre-multiply. And if I compare that, now we've got all these hair details back, and that looks actually quite nice. Okay, so that's the basic keying workflow. And now I want to talk a bit more about masking. And for that, maybe we can get rid of some of these problems here in the masks. So let's create a garbage mat or a core mat. So I go back to the masking interface, go full screen. Okay, and now first of all, I want to create a core mask to mask out all this stuff so that this doesn't get keyed. And for that, to make it stick to the background, I want to track another point. So I go back to the tracking interface, tap one, so tracking, and now maybe one marker here. And actually, this is a pretty bad preset, so the search area is too big, the pattern area is too small, but this should work. Okay, so that's fine. And now I want to add another mask. So tap 4 to the mask interface. And hang on, one thing that I forgot is we've tracked the head, but we didn't do anything with that. So before I continue, I want to go to one frame where the mask of the head is on the right position, and then parent this mask to this track. And to do that, currently this track is active. To select this one, when you are in the masking mode, then you control right click on this marker. And if you have everything here selected, control P to parent that. Now, okay, so here in the active point, you can see it is parented to this point. Okay, so next thing, I want to create another mask. To do that, I go here, press this little plus sign, and you notice that every new mask, maybe this can be the core mask, give it a name, has this fake user button enabled, which is very handy, because if you first start creating all the mask for the background, maybe for some errors here in the green, and then core masks, object masks, stuff like that, and you don't use them yet in the node editor, then they would have zero user. So if you save the file and open it again, your mask would be lost. So by creating this fake user, you make sure that every one of them has a user, so it wouldn't be deleted by Blender's garbage collection on save and reload. Anyway, now that we have this new mask, I can again control click here. And because these are all geometrical shapes, I don't need these handles to create curves. Instead, I press V to set the handle type and set it to vector. Now there is only one point, and if I control click here, you can see that now I can create these straight lines. So I could go ahead and maybe mask out these shapes like so. Then Alt-C to close that, and there's a little bug which would go away if you move them and update that. Okay, so now if I play back with Alt-A or just scrub through the shot, then you can see that this is a bit problematic. So I shift left click to go back to the beginning, then control right click on this point, press control P to parent them, and now if you go through the shot, they will stick to that position. Okay, so that's nice. And currently, they will have harsh edges. So I think in this case, it wouldn't be a problem. But let's just say that there would be more green spill here. In this case, if you have something like that, you would see that edge. So if I now go here and maybe just duplicate that mask and switch it from mask to core and control left click on that, you can see these have now these harsh edges. Actually, toggling anti-alias should do something. But what I wanted to show you is that now you have this core mask, so these white areas define what should not be keyed. So if I put this into the core mat input and then look at my mat, now this is all solid white. Whereas if you disconnect that, you can see these problems here. Now the thing is that if you have these harsh edges, then this is of course very visible. So if you would, so if you see that, you also have this problem right here. That is problematic, and to solve that, you could use the feathering. So if you shift left click here and want to drag out the feather, currently I can't do that. The problem is that I've created the mask in the wrong direction. Now let's go back for a second to the aligned mode so that you can see the vectors. And the vectors for the control of these curve points point to the inside. And that depends on in which direction you create the mask. So if I control left click here and go clockwise, it will point to the inside. If I create them counterclockwise, they point to the outside. And this is both. This is a bit crappy. Well, in this case, what we can do is to switch the direction here. Now they point to the outside. And now even if you switch everything by hitting A to select every point, by switching back to the vector mode, now I can shift click here and drag these points out so that we have this feathering. So that's a bit bad because, I mean, currently you cannot even use feathering to the inside. This would be hopefully fixed for Blender 2.65. Currently, you have to make sure that you create your masks counterclockwise or use the switch direction function. Anyway, now that we have this feathering, if I go here, you see that we have feathering. And in the key, this is now not so problematic anymore because now there is this smooth transition and that doesn't create these problems. So what I would do is to create it so that you have a little bit of space between the edge of the object and this feathered area so that we can do something like this, so that there are nicer transitions. Maybe the feather area is in fact a bit too large, so I want to shrink it. And you can do that by scale feather using this operator over here. First select everything, scale feather, and then do that. Or you grab one of the feather points with your left mouse button, then you can do that point by point. And now if I hold down the Alt key, I can grow and shrink every point. I think I've let go the Alt key too fast. Oh, no, haha. No, it's not a bug, but this is a different problem. This is in some places in Blender problematic. So if I do this with the Alt key, this currently doesn't work for me. The reason for that is in my user prefs, because I've set it by default to use the emulate three button option. So Blender thinks I'm emulating the middle mouse button with the Alt key, and that's why this doesn't work. Now, if I turn this off and do the same action again with Alt left mouse button and I let go now, it will work. So that is a little problem. In that case, if you have to use the emulate three button feature, you can do that with the scale feather. But actually, I do hope that we get this fixed at some point. Okay, so now we have that core mask, at least for the objects down here. So This looks now a bit better. So in the mat, this is now everything filled up. Now there are some areas that are problematic here, and to fix that, this is here. You can either create new points on this curve by control clicking here onto the line, and that will create new control points. Then you can drag out the shape and do that, but this doesn't really make sense and is not very nice. Instead, you can create a new mask layer. And mask layers are not these things. This is really a mask object, so to say, or just the mask. Before I continue, I want to get rid of this point, so X to delete that. So instead, I want to use a new mask layer. And you can do that over here by first naming that, maybe this is the main. And then I want to create another mask for this object here. And to do that, I press this little plus sign, create a new mask layer, and call that thingy. And now if I deselect everything here and control click, I will create a new mask in the active mask layer, which is here. But if a point here would still be active and I click here, then if I'm not lucky, or if I click here, then I will now work on the main mask. So if you don't want that, and if you want to be sure that you don't change the previous mask, you can turn off the editability or selectability of this mask. So now you can click here and nothing will happen. So it will only work in the active and editable mask layer. So now I can also press A and erase everything. If this would be active and I press A, all this would be selected as well. So this is very nice, and I can now create a mask for this thing here. Alt C to close that, and then maybe a little bit of feathering by shift left clicking here on one of these points. And now also, even though it is not right here, I want to parent that to this point, so just control P since this marker is still active. Now playback does work. Now if I go back here, I will see the update. So this is now also inside of that mask, and I can use that as a core mask, so this is now also filled. Now I want to go a little bit more into detail about the mask, and especially rotoscoping, how you can animate that, by having a look at the last part of the shot where he grabs his arm gun. So of course this would have to be replaced with a CG model, and to do that we have to get rid of this thing. Now of course this cannot be keyed, so we have to mask that. So first of all, I'm creating a new mask, call that arm gun, so that we can control that separately. And then, well, the first thing would be maybe to create a mask around that. So if you, let's just do it very roughly. I just do that. So I have this mask, and now I can of course also parent it to a marker, but there are so many movements here, especially here, that maybe this wouldn't be enough. So instead we would have to animate that, and that is of course rotoscoping. And to do that you have to set keyframes. To set a keyframe, you can press I for a keyframe, and that inserts a shape key. You can see here you have this little orange line, so that is indicating that there you have a keyframe. So you can now go a few frames back, then move the mask and create another keyframe. And now this is interpolating between these two keyframes. Of course, now we have to go here and adjust that and set a keyframe. And you have to do that for everything that you do. You have to insert manually a keyframe unless you enable auto key. And of course, for rotoscoping, this would be very handy. So in the timeline, you just press this button for auto key, and now everything that you do will be automatically keyed. And the keying here is for the whole mask. So if you only change one marker or one point, you will have keyframes for the whole mask. So you don't have to care about what marker you, what point you are moving. There will be keyframes always for the whole thing. Okay, I'm just doing it very roughly here. So here I have to move it down, then adjust that, And I'm just grabbing that with the G key and then with the left mouse button, if they are selected, you can just grab them. You can also, if you press A to deselect them, move them with the right mouse button. But being able to move them with the left mouse button is also very nice, because then with A you can have everything selected. So now you can move single points, but you can also press G to move the whole thing. So that's very nice. But then what happens if you come to this part of the shot? So now, so from here to there. Now here, if I want to remove the arm, in this case I would also remove this, of course. So what do? Either I can try to key this shape, but that would be stupid because it would be a lot of work and it doesn't really fit anyway. So the easier thing would be to do something like Boolean operations on these masks. So you can do that either in the compositor, of course, by creating another mask and then subtracting that, but you can do that right there in the mask layers. So this could be the main mask for the arm, and you can see that there is a blend mode which is set to merge add. So every new mask layer that you add like this will be added to this mask. So if I go to the node editor and have a look at that mask, this is now adding. Now the merge add has to do with a feather. So if you have feathering for both of these masks like so, it looks very nice. But if I set this mode, where is it, to just add, it looks a bit different. So you get these overshooting areas, and merge add behaves a bit nicer. But the thing that we want to do is to not do this, so I just delete that. Instead, I want to have a new mask layer for this shape. This can be a very easy mask, and again I've created that with the wrong direction. So I just click here, switch direction, and now I can maybe set it to vector, and then here drag out a bit feather to have this nice unsharp area. Like so. Okay, and now I can set this to merge subtract, and the result will be this. So if I now maybe deselect that, if I now move the mask, or we can just watch the animation, it will disappear behind this mask or behind this mask layer. Now you might have noticed that when I go through the animation that the feathering for this mask is suddenly changing. And the reason for that is that the feathering is part of the overall animation. So if you first animate your whole mask and after that create the feathering, then you would have to control the feather for every keyframe that you have here. So I would have to go one frame forward and then drag out the feather again and then do that for every point. Well, that is of course not very efficient, and for that you can use the button feather reset animation. So you would go to one frame where you have the feather that you want to have, and then go to this button, feather reset animation, and that will now apply the feathering to your mask for the entire animation. Well, ideally you would do it right from the start. So you create your mask, then create your keys if you're keying, and then insert your mask right away and apply that mask to your node setup so that you can really see what you are doing. So for example, if this would be something that I want to cut out, then I could go ahead and let's see, what is this? Okay, well, this is zoomed in. So you could use this and then maybe invert that if you're using multiple masks, and now multiply that over your alpha channel like so. And now you see what you're actually doing. So if I now go to the composite and start creating my mask, then I can right away also control the feathering, because that really lets you see what you have to do and how far you have to go in. Of course, you could also do that right here. So if you're animating, do that while you are seeing the composite result. All right. Now you've just seen that I have to invert the mask if I want to do this. So the mask comes out white at first, and then I invert that so that I can multiply that. But you can also invert a mask from the mask editor. So if I go here, and then here, I can invert that. So make this black. So if you look at this, this is now black. Now, of course, that also means that all these blend operations are different now. So if I look at this, this is also black, and that is because this is subtracting from something that is already subtracting. So this would now have to be merge add. So your entire blend stuff would be inverted, sort of. So that's why in some cases, especially if you have lots of masks here, I think it's easier to just invert the resulting mask in the node editor. But you can also do that from here. So if I subtract that and invert this, this of course gives another different result. So you have to kind of see what you want to do. Now, the other thing is, and just let me go back to what I had before. So this what subtract and like this. Okay. So if you want to animate that, the influence of a mask, then you can also do that from here. For example, using a math node and then in, animating this. Or you just animate the opacity. So this can now be keyed by bringing the mouse over that and press I. You have a keyframe, then you go forward and then set this to 0 or something and press I for keyframe. And now you have animated this mask. Another thing that is good to know for masking is here in the active spline setting. So you can change the feather offset behavior. So for example, if I go back to the to this mode for my mask, you can see that certain shapes create weird results. So the way that the feather line here is behaving is not really ideal. But you can change that by switching the feather offset from even to smooth. That will also create some problematic results, like here for example, because here you have the feather going through the main line. And also that creates different problems. But in some cases, this can make it really nicer and smoother. So just compare how this is now moving to the one that we had before. So these edges would not be there if you do that. You can also use a self-intersection check if you are in even. So if I now do this, it will sort of collapse into itself. So this is also a way to get rid of these self-intersecting problems. So there are in fact some ways to control the feathering, especially if you have different feather offsets. So this is of course not so nice, but if you set this to smooth, so this is behaving now a bit different. Then if you want to change the display for the mask, then you can also do that by going to Mark Display, and then you can draw smooth splines. If you want to, you can also set it to white. So that just depends on what you like best. Then if you want to control the animation here, then you can do that from the dope sheet. So if I go here and then maybe divide my node editor so that I can open up the dope sheet over here, then I switch that from dope sheet to this new mode, which is the mask mode. Now I have all my keyframes for the mask here. So now I can just grab them and move them or change the timing and everything. So that is also a nice way to control your keyframes here. And the last thing that I want to show you is that you can also control and use the masks not only from the movie clip editor, but also from the UV image editor. So for instance, if you don't need any of the tracking features, then especially then it's very helpful to use the UV image editor, because the advantage is that, well, you do see the viewer node here. Where is it, by the way? So, okay, so here we've got the viewer node. And the viewer node, or the viewer node result, can be also shown in the, maybe let me bypass this, can be also shown in the UV image editor. So if I switch that, then I can display the viewer node result. And now we have this new option here to switch from view to paint or to mask. So now I can grab my arm gun mask and have that here and can control that like this. Well, I'm bypassing that so we don't really see that. But if I control shift click here, then now I can see the mask. And the nice thing is that if you have use nodes enabled, you can see the result more or less in real time. So you can control that from here and exactly see what you are doing. If you need the controls, then they are in the T panel. So if you press T, the thing is in the viewer node, N and T are kind of flipped, which is a bit not so nice. So in this case, you have to press T to bring up the tool shelf, and the masks are below all these histogram and vectorscope windows. So there you have the mask settings and the mask layers. So you can again control that. So everything that you had in the movie clip editor, you also have here. And now, depending on what mask you use and what display you have, you can control everything nicely from here. So the core mask can also be controlled by doing that. And if you have a look here, you don't even need the node editor. You just go full screen in the UV image editor and then you can see the results. So if I move over here, then you can see what's happening. So everything that you do will be calculated in the node editor and you will see the result here in this UV image window. Okay, so that's it about keying and masking. Of course, rotoscoping could be another tutorial, but I think to get familiar with the tools, this should be enough. So have fun with keying and roto in Blender.